the war against certainty. There is a war against certainty. It's been going on for quite some time. Now, each one of us is either leaning towards belief or towards certainty, one or the other. It's impossible to be leaning both ways the same way, right in the middle. If you believe, you're right in the middle, you're leaning towards belief. So belief or certainty, belief or certainty. If we're leaning towards certainty, which I am, then it's time to go for it. Just go for it. It is time to go all out, which is why these videos are going all out, saying stuff that most people would not say, because they're still trying to appease belief. They're still trying to appease belief. So they won't say these things. But in my case, I'm saying, you know what? I want to go all in towards certainty. So let's just lay all the cards on the table, spill all the beans. There's definitely a war against certainty going on, a vicious war. And this planet, it's succeeding. It is succeeding to an alarming extent. And those of us who are leaning towards certainty, we need to go for it, really go for it. So what we're doing here is we're finding out what really going for it means. Okay. I'm doing a lot of videos this weekend because I might as well do as many as possible when I can, when I have the opportunity. I've been on a diet for about 2 weeks and I've lost 10 pounds in 2 weeks, but I'm feeling the effects of it very strongly now. I'm feeling the bite of that crash diet. So I'm trying to, you know, drink something to help out. £10 in 2 weeks is not bad at all. But I tell you, I was very lightheaded last night, and today I'm starting to feel, weak. As the body is, you know, converted to burning fat, it's feeling the stress of it. And it's not easy. When you get older, a crash diet is not easy. I've been on mostly liquids, very few solids really at all. Just some soups, vegetable soups, along with a lot of liquids and fruit juices and things like that. But it's working. Let me see if I can hang in there. Might be difficult to work. But this shows, this is part of going for it right now. You know, you have to go all in, because the war against certainty is, its goal is to wipe out any attraction to certainty in this world. That's its goal. And it's advancing towards that goal as fast as possible. Fast as possible. And it has so much momentum right now. You have to calculate the momentum in there. And it's like a rout. You know, it's really routing those who have been loyal to certainty, have begun to equivocate and have gone into like appeasement mode, a lot of them. It's important to note that everything that I do is, I claim no intellectual copyright or property or ownership whatsoever of any of this. Because it's we're all one, and whatever I can share is, I know that it's, you have the very same clarity within you. You have certainty within you. It's just that you're trying to, we're all trying to some extent to appease belief. We're afraid of belief, what it might do to us. So we may not be able to quite bring it through like this. But the fact is, anything that I say, everyone else has the very same clarity and more. So how can I possibly say that somehow this is my intellectual property? Like somehow I came up with it, no, and I own it. It belongs to me. That is ridiculous. Really, it's a red flag. If anybody claims intellectual copyright property rights to what they are sharing with the world, that's a red flag. That is really a red flag. Look out for that. Should be public domain. No claim of intellectual property rights whatsoever. That means when you come up with something the same or similar, you feel like, hey, that's perfectly okay. I'm not, you know, taking something from somebody else, you know, that I'm going to be sued for it, or I'm going to be a bad person because I'm stealing their intellectual property. That is ridiculous. So you can come up with the same clarity. You can come up with the same insights. I'm not claiming any intellectual property rights at all. It's a privilege to be able to share this. So look out for that red flag. When you see that red flag, you should assume that there's someone there who's trying to appease belief. And you have a mixed message there. And look out for that. Be very, very wary of that. Because you know, it's amazing what happens in the in spiritual teaching, etc. Those who claim, you know, that they're the only ones that can come up with this, but whatever they give the world, they're the only ones that can do that. You might wonder, what in the world are they thinking? They must think that they're special. The fact is that every last thing that any teacher of God, teacher of truth, teacher of certainty can share with the world, you have the exact same certainty within you. Everybody has the exact same certainty within them. It's that it's clouded over and you're still engaged with belief to some extent. But when you disengage from belief, you will know exactly the truth and you will know certainty just as well as anyone. You will know it as well as Jesus, Ramana, Anandamayi, Buddha, etc. You will know exactly the same certainty. And you will be able to express that in exactly the same way or different ways. But you know everybody else has the very same creativity, very same certainty. So it is only belief claims intellectual property rights. Only belief does that. Not certainty. Certainty is not concerned about intellectual property rights and copyright and all that stuff. It is not concerned with that. So there's no worries, you know, about using any of this information to say it, you know, to share it, etc. You're not stepping on anybody's property, intellectual property rights by doing that, which frees you up. Takes away the fear, takes away the guilt. I can't tell you how much guilt and fear I've had from just trying to share what somebody else has said and pass it on and say, oh, it's copyright. You know, they might claim intellectual copyright. So I had to come up, you know, with my own words, et cetera, to come from within. Just because these people, they all copyright their stuff. It is ridiculous. It's a compromise. They're compromised by doing that. What are they thinking? Again, they're special. And the ones who say, I'm the exclusive conduit for this truth. Exclusive conduit for certainty. We all have certainty within us. We are certainty. Our identity is certainty. Reality is certain of reality. It is reality. We all, that is what we are. How can somebody say they're exclusive conduit, you know? It's just pathetic. They should say, I'm the non-exclusive conduit. So I'm saying, I'm a non-exclusive conduit for the first step of clarification, which leads to the second step of being able to abide in the presence of certainty. The non-exclusive clarifier with no intellectual property rights claim whatsoever. So, you know, that's a huge benefit. To everybody, there's no guilt involved. You can follow the thread of this and come up with something, and you say, hey, it's okay if I come up with something that's very similar, or even if I use the same words or similar words, or it's a derivative of it, etc., etc. It's fine. It all comes from the same source anyway. It all comes from certainty. So how can someone say to be they're the exclusive source when it's certainty itself that is the source? It's reality itself that is the source. So pay attention to those red flags. And those that say, everything is going great, we're all progressing in the world, pay attention to that. We're not. There's a vicious war against certainty in this world. And the safeguards are collapsing. The situation is becoming extremely inhospitable for anyone who is truly loves certainty and wants to share and express that love of certainty. Most messages in this world are highly, highly compromised. Highly compromised. They're really appeasement of belief, and oftentimes just belief shrouded in the rhetoric, in spiritual rhetoric. That is a fact. Very hard to find uncompromised messages in this world. So look for that also. Just be aware. Be aware at all times. Just say, hey, you know, is this giving me a clear path to my love of certainty? Is this really moving me, you know, attracting me and saying, hey, it's okay, the love of certainty is perfect, it's great, it's okay? Or is it paying lip service to that, but actually enmeshing you in belief? That is the question. And as this war against certainty has continued, what I found is messages get more and more and more and more compromised in the world. Basically, they're trying to please both belief and certainty, which is absolute folly. Absolutely, whoever is doing that is not awakened. Has not stepped beyond belief, gone beyond time, and it's not chosen a different idea, and is not abiding in unconditional love and the certainty of that unconditional love. They have not done that. They might believe that they've done it, and then build a castle made of sand of belief in that with rhetoric, but it's compromised. The message is compromised. And we will find, after the U.S. election, we will find that Pandora's box will be truly opened. The lid has been pried open, but soon it's going to be completely open. And the war against certainty will be unequivocal. It will be no shame in it. It will just be a massive rout, you know. Like once the defenses get routed, as it were, in an army, then the massacre starts, the mopping up, you know, it's chaos. There's that point, tipping point, where all pretense to civility is discarded, and the methods of madness are employed, and we're very close to that tipping point right now. And, you know, if you're aware of this, you can see the red flags of the statements that people make with no shame, very bold-faced. So I find it necessary to be the counterpart to that and give direct talk about just how bad it is and just what exactly is really going on here and how to avoid getting sucked up in that, how to avoid the rout. How to avoid it from getting routed. We can't pull any punches right now. Cannot pull any punches. Because very soon, those who are warring against certainty, if they're warring against the attraction to certainty, they will not be pulling any more punches either. And it's best, we have every right to be warned of that ahead of time. Every right. Because the attraction to certainty, we cannot get rid of it. It is what we are. We are attracted to what we are. And what we are is eternal and can never be changed. So it's the war against certainty is exercise in futility. It's madness. It's insanity. And gets nowhere. And so we have every right to discard it. To realize that this is exercise in futility. It's merely wasting time. It's meaningless. Therefore, we don't want it. We don't really want it. So if we really don't want something, we have the right, inherently right, to choose a different idea. That is reality. We are free to choose our experiencing in reality. And therefore, we're absolutely within our rights and authority to choose a new idea and say this attempt to change reality, we don't really want it. We don't really want it. And so we need to exercise that right. If we don't exercise that right, then our attraction to certainty will be undermined. Absolutely will be undermined. And we'll start making compromise after compromise after compromise. Most of us are compromised to some extent, but we have to keep moving our attraction towards certainty and shedding that compromised position more and more and more and more and more. Very few in this world have ever come into the world who did not try to compromise. Very few. And they're notable by their rarity. Very notable. I said in a previous video, make up your own little jingles. I made one up today. Anandamayama without a flaw. Anandamayama without a flaw. Meaning no compromise with belief. 100% abiding in certainty. Every moment of a life without a flaw. Very rare that anyone does not compromise. So we have to admit, yeah, we've compromised to some extent, but we're moving away from that compromise. And when we see the world now insisting that we be 100%ers towards belief, we say, no. We've had enough with compromise. We're not certainly not going to increase it. And in fact, we want to decrease the compromise. So absolutely, we're not going to go along with that. Then we really have to go for it and go all in. And these videos give you a taste of going all in. And maybe you realize, hey, there's more that you can do. There's more that you can do as far as discarding, disengaging with belief, with compromise. It's belief that believes in compromise. Certainty doesn't believe in compromise. There's no compromise. Certainty knows there's no compromise. Certainty is 100% certain, and that's the only thing that's real. That is real. But belief believes that it can accommodate certainty, integrate it, so to speak. It cannot. It cannot. Where there's certainty, there's no belief. That's not integration. You can't be, 50-50. No, certainty is always certain. You might be compromised and vacillating, but certainty is still 100% certain. And belief is 100% belief. You cannot alter belief to be some other thing, and you cannot alter certainty to be some other situation. You cannot. You can only choose one or the other. You can be either attracted to one or the other. And ultimately, the only attraction we really have is to certainty. Certainty is what we love, and that's established for us. We didn't establish the love of certainty. It is established for us because we were created by certainty. We are a child of certainty, child of fact, a child of reality, child of isness, a child of eternalness, of invulnerability, of perfect freedom. We are the child of that. And so we can never separate from that. It's not possible. But belief rejects all of that entirely. At its very premise, it rejects any fact, anything that's real. Rejects reality. And this war on certainty in the world is to, insist that that we must abandon our love of certainty. We must abandon it. We must disavow it. In the past, like in Christianity started out, the Roman Empire persecuted them severely, and they would say, you must forsake Christ or else you're going to be crucified, executed. And they said, no, I'm not going to disavow my love of Christ, meaning love of certainty, love of reality. They said, no, I'm not going to disavow it. And they said, well, if you don't disavow, we're going to put you to death. That's the actions of belief. Belief would love to put everyone to death. Everyone. Not just those who are attracted to certainty, but because belief knows we're all attracted to certainty, so it would love to put all of us to death. And then rebirth us again in flesh, and then put us to death again. And then rebirth us again, and put us to death again. As a matter of fact, that's exactly what belief has been doing since the beginning of belief, is raising up to strike down. Raising up to strike down. Trying to find a way to destroy reality. Get us a true disavowal of reality. Some kind of disavowal that is true. How can truth disavow itself? It cannot. It cannot. So it's futile. All this raising up bodies and striking them down is just an exercise, a meaningless exercise in futility. And it goes, and belief, that's all that belief has. It's all that it does. And it wants to do it again. It wants to do it in a big way now. And it's setting that up. It's setting that up. So in the days and weeks and months ahead, we will find out how it progresses for those who are attracted to certainty, who have decided Certainty is what we want. That is what we really love. We'll always love it. It's futile to try and disavow that. It's just a waste of time. Complete waste of time. We can go through these cycles of birth and death endlessly, and at that point, we will almost endlessly, and at a certain point, we'll realize the attraction is still there, as always, to certainty. And then we'll say, oh my gosh, I didn't have to go through any of this. Complete waste of time. There was never any chance I could get rid of that attraction, that love of certainty, of reality. So why keep going along that path at all of birth and death, cycles of birth and death? Only belief within belief are there these cycles of birth and death, birth and death, birth and death. That's the cycles of that come from belief. They don't come from certainty. Certainty is, there's no birth and death of certainty. There's no, it is perfect, flawless life right now. Always steady, unthreatened, unchangeable. No cycles of birth and death whatsoever. No sickness, no dying, no death, none of that. All of that arises within the belief system. Within a belief system that wants to try and destroy reality. So that threaten the destruction of reality, that force the prime creator to change reality and make spirit prime creator. That is the root of it all. So we want to find out for ourselves, committing to leaning and being attracted to certainty and forsaking uncertainty, forsaking belief. What is our dispensation? What happens to us under those circumstances? And I'm making myself a guinea pig is what I'm doing for the sake of everybody here. Is, you know, I'm going all in and seeing what happens to me. By going all in, I mean I'm expressing what is taking place in this world to the extent where I'm persona non grata, to say the very least. At least to belief for sure. Basically just reporting, being an honest reporter. You know, there are no hardly any honest reporters in the world anymore. The media is completely compromised. Completely compromised. Politics is completely compromised. Okay. The whole purpose of the media is to be the fourth estate and to be an objective, unbiased vetter of those in power, because we know power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. So everybody in a position of power, you have to assume that they're going to be tempted to be corrupted. And the purpose of the media is to expose that corruption in light of fire and scare people in power to not fall for that temptation of corruption, or to minimize it. That's the whole purpose of the media. And they've completely abandoned that purpose. They're 100% now in the tank for the war against certainty. They've compromised with belief. They're you know, they've given up any pretense now to actual objectivity and pointing out corruption, because those in power have said, hey, you know, there's a war against certainty, and you're either with us or against us. And they, to maintain their position of influence and power, they've had to compromise and decide that they're going to give up their objectivity and stop vetting those in power. They don't do the job anymore at all. So you're not hearing anything legitimate coming from the media. It's a waste of time. I don't listen to the media at all anymore. It's just a complete waste of time. And they never did say much of importance anyway. Their job is to put limits on the amount of corruption that those in power can do out of the fear of exposure. But now those in power don't fear exposure, really. They don't, because the media is in the tank, in the bag for them. So they don't fear exposure, so they feel they can do anything they want to do, which is the whole plan when you get a pogrom going, when you get a situation, a war against certainty going. The media and the government are in cahoots, two sides of the same coin, so that those in power don't fear getting vetted, don't fear getting exposed for what they're doing, and so then they can pursue the re-education camps, the exterminations, all the terrible types of pogroms that have come up, you know, in history. Whenever we surrender to belief, we're surrendering to an external authority and not trusting our inner knowing, okay, our inner knowing. And we think that something, some political leader outside of us knows better than we do. But really, those outside of us, just belief. It's just belief. And so when we're surrendered to belief, we get these powerful leaders who we trust and we submit to them and we believe that they know what's best for us. We believe that they know best for us. And then they carry out all these terrible massacres and re-educations and concentration camps and all these types of things that have arisen. And most people, you know, don't even pay attention to it. Like, they just, because the media doesn't even report it. Doesn't even report it. So it's happened in the 20th century quite extensively. So when the media and the government are really one and the same, two sides of the same coin, then you the door is wide open for extreme abuse, extreme corruption from those in power, and those in power are empowered by those who are loyal to belief and want to follow the guidance of belief. Okay, those who lean attracted to certainty know that they have the certainty within them, and then they respect others who attract them to certainty. Okay, but they know that we are one, we all share the same certainty. And like, if I were to see a teacher of certainty, an ambassador of certainty, I would completely respect them and cherish and love them, but I also know that, you know, the certainty is within me too. So we're equal, not equal in time and space and within this belief system, I understand that, but in reality we're equal, and that it's only the attraction to certainty which is important. That's all that's really important. There's a different dynamic at play, different than those who are trying to glorify political leaders, people in political power over their lives like that. That is a very different dynamic. And basically, they give power to try to give absolute power to political leaders, so the political leaders will carry out the pogroms to get rid of all those who are leaning loyal to certainty. And that's what happens in this world. I mean, if you know anything about the history of this planet, you know, you would truly be appalled by what has happened here. And it's all because of belief, loyalty to belief. And now, never more than ever, people in this world are loyal to belief, more than ever, because belief is able to market itself in much more sophisticated ways now. It's able to market itself in such a slick way that more and more and more people are becoming more and more compromised. And before, it's kind of easy, you know, to tell the difference between the devil and Christ, as it were, between belief and certainty. That's what it means. The devil means belief, and Christ means certainty. And it was, you know, not quite as difficult to know, wow, this is definitely belief and this is definitely certainty. But now the way that belief is marketing itself, it's gotten quite, you know, more difficult, because belief seems to present a very pretty face, a very glamorous face to the world, a very marketable face. And it tugs at our heartstrings. It tries everything possible to market itself. Super clever. And it is really a burden. It is a strain. It is a difficulty to continuously vet it and say no to that, you know. And it always pops up with more and more and more formats and marketing campaigns, etc. It's relentless, absolutely relentless now. So we are under just a relentless assault. Our attraction to certainty is under a relentless assault. like a constant bombardment. And we're all vulnerable to it. I mean, if we weren't, we'd have perfect certainty. Right? Only perfect certainty is not vulnerable to being, you know, tempted towards belief. So certainly we would welcome anything that insulates us from this bombardment. And like these videos are kind of like saying, hey, it's okay to recognize you're under bombardment. You don't have to be in denial of it. You don't have to be saying, ah, how wonderful it is, you know, that this, everything's happening right now, how wonderful it is. you know, that just adds to trouble. If you say, my gosh, under severe bombardment to try and attract me away from my attraction to certainty, and this bombardment's getting worse and worse and worse, then at least you're aware, like, you know what, maybe I should, you know, insulate myself from this bombardment. But it's so difficult, there's so few speaking up and saying, you know, you are under a bombardment. The world is under this most incredible assault. It's not only an assault by people of the earth, it's assault by various extraterrestrials too, who want this earth to be a center, a home for belief. They want to eradicate any attraction to certainty whatsoever here. It's super important for them. They want it to be a place where there's not a shred of attraction to certainty, and where anyone who even remotely thinks of that will self-censor themselves like that, or else face a draconian punishment for it. And they are hell-bent on doing just that. So it's not just the people of this world. That this world has been severely influenced by certain extraterrestrial races that have subtly infiltrated the belief system here and manipulated the belief system here in such a way that we are like, you know, willingly going into slavery, into enslavement to belief, and building this world, structuring this world in every way possible to accommodate a certainty-free environment, as it were. That's exactly what's going on. It's been going on for quite some time now. The last 50 years have been very intense. And the last 15 have been, you know, all-out warfare. And the war is almost ready to be wrapped up, almost finished. It's not like, you know, there's some people who are waiting for the war. What do you mean? The last 15 years have been an intense all-out war. Spiritual warfare has been going on. And it's not that those who are loyal to certainty have been vanquished. It's just those who are loyal to belief are fleeing from certainty as fast as they can. Meaning that they don't want any attraction to certainty at this time. They're trying to cut off their attraction. And cutting off attraction to certainty to a certain degree means investing another cycle of belief. Cycle of existence, cycle of belief. Same thing. That's all. Those who remain loyal to certainty have no more reason to have any more cycles of belief, no more birth and death, no reason whatsoever. So their destiny is truly a glorious one. And the others are simply delaying another cycle of belief, where they will then have to recultivate their attraction to certainty. It's within them, but they have to start disengaging from belief, and they'll, you know, however long it takes them, that's how long it takes them. The opportunity will come for them. But right now, they are reinvesting in another cycle. That's all that's happening. It's sad. It's really sad. But there's nothing you can do, anyone can do, about someone else's decision. Not a thing you can do. All you can do is attract to certainty. You can lead a horse to water. You can't make him drink. Cannot. But we can continue to drink of attraction to certainty. The best is yet to come. The best is yet to come. those who remain loyal to certainty, who say, no, certainty is my true love, my one and only true love. Certainty is my one and only true love, will always be, and there's no point in pretending otherwise. Wow, the rewards that come with that are incredible. And so it's something to really look forward to. And the perspective about others who don't get that is one of simply they will go through a certain amount of more delay, that's all. So no pity, you know, they're nothing like that. Those who are awake, 100% certainty, they see the big picture. They say, well, you know, a few more lifetimes, don't worry about it, you know. They have the perspective, the big picture, and from their standpoint, there's nothing to be traumatized about if someone refuses certainty at this point. You know, it's just a minor delay. In the big scheme of things, it's a minor delay. And it's because they're not quite ready to go all the way with certainty. They want to spend a little more time in delusion. That's perfectly fine. That's perfectly okay. And we just need to retain our viability to be of service at some point down the road. The certainty that is what we are may appear in some world, someplace, and help attract others to that certainty. That might happen. It may happen, it may not happen. But certainly, some appearance of certainty will take place. Always. Never without the certainty of God, the grace of God is always present and will always make appearances to those who need that appearance to help attract them to certainty. It's always the way that it works. Just don't claim exclusivity. That's belief. You know, saying this is the only appearance of certainty there will ever be. Who's saying that? Belief is saying that, because belief doesn't want any more. Belief says, oh, one is terrible enough. The idea of another appearance is just no way can I believe in that. You know, just it's too terrible to even contemplate. So belief will say, well, yeah, okay, there's one, but that's it. Never another one. This has to be the exclusive one and only appearance of certainty there will ever be. And if you don't accept this one, you're damned to hell forever. Meeting. It's a belief saying there will never be another one, knowing that most people will not accept this appearance, and then they feel they have no choice but to go with belief from that point on. See how that works? Belief is very clever. Each appearance of certainty will attract a certain number to certainty, not everyone. And so by saying this is the one and only appearance and you'll never have another opportunity, belief then dispirits so many say, oh my gosh, you know, that's it and I can't get with it. Therefore, I got no choice but to go with belief. And so I have to really try to engage with belief entirely and get with that. Very bad thing. No such thing as an exclusive appearance of certainty. Certainty will always appear until the end of time in different appearances. Whatever appearance is useful at a certain time and place, certainty will appear. And it's always the same certainty that is appearing. It's always perfect certainty. Never exclusive. One thing I admire about certain traditions is there's no claim of exclusivity. That's very helpful, actually. Reality has always been certain of itself. There's no point where reality became certain of itself. It's always been from the very beginning. So it is certainty appearing to those who need to be attracted to certainty is just the automatic grace of reality, inescapable, bound to happen over and over and over and over again in different times and places. Because as belief reinvests in another cycle, it will reject all previous appearances of certainty in the cycle that they just went through. It will forget all about them, reject them entirely, and when they have a new cycle, they'll need to have new appearances of certainty. Which is why right now there's this, you know, tremendous attempt to undermine Jesus, and forget about Ananda Maima, forget about Ramana Maharshi, forget about the various appearances of certainty that have taken place in this world, and to scoff at them and say that anybody believes in those is somehow inferior, of intellect, or stupid, incapable, you know, suffering from some you know, mental disorder, that kind of thing. They're just trying their best to, again, completely forget and reject any appearances of certainty in this cycle that we're just ending right now. And so they can begin a new cycle, fresh and clean, as it were, committed to belief. And within that new cycle, then, there will be an appearance of certainty at some point that will happen. And they'll give a name to it, you know. And then at some point, probably another one, and another one, another. They'll give various names to that and go through the whole thing again, you know. And again and again until they get it. Until they get it. This is an overview on existence. You know, you get the overview, then you start saying, wow, it's not very attractive. Not very attractive at all. Because, you know, why wait? You know, we have the certainty. We are the certainty. The appearances of certainty just are reminding us of what we are, what we already have. They just remind us, and they attract us to what we already are, what we are, which is certainty. Which is knowing, which is no doubt. They just remind us, hey, you know, this is what you really love. And we say, ah, yeah. We believe we're loving the teacher, the guru, the savior, whatever. No, we're loving the certainty within that they're expressing. Because we're really loving the certainty, and we are that certainty. Everyone is that certainty. Everyone has it within and is that. That is true identity. So instead of watching the big football game that's on right now, we're, you know, doing this taping here, doing the taping, because it's more important. There are choices that have to be made, you know. Don't try to do it all right now. Make some choices. How you spend your time. I could be saying, well, I want to spend 3 hours watching a football game, and then maybe I can do the taping stuff. No. Do the taping first. In other words, do the inquiry first. Do the satsang first. You can catch up with the news later. You can find out the final score and the plays, etc. if you want to. You can, there's also a playoff baseball game going on. No, I'm not going to do that. You can find out later. That's, you know, that's only what I want. What I really want is to continue attraction, continue to gravitate towards certainty. So in your life, you can do the same thing as gravitate towards certainty just by saying, making decisions like, let's put this first, and the rest of the stuff, you know, we'll put that on the back burner for now. Maybe we'll get to it later. Don't have to deny it or say never. Say, you know, later. You know, maybe it'll be time to catch up on the scores later or whatever. Give a little, you know, gossip, social talk, chit-chat, maybe later. Maybe attend that lunch, you know, maybe later. Do this a little bit later. And that's how you make progress. You have to put the time in. It's not going to happen magically. because belief is that tar baby. You know, we've been carrying this tar baby around, and suddenly we want to set it down, and we say, uh-oh, it's stuck to us. And we have to start, you know, prying that, you know, stickiness away, that stick 'em away from us. And it keeps wanting to stick to us. It keeps bullying us, keeps intimidating us in many, many ways. And so we put the time in, and we manage to disengage more and more and more. Beautiful day here in California. We're severely spoiled here, say the least. Take it for granted. But it's pretty amazing. You feel guilty here for not being happy. Because as if weather could bring happiness. You know, we think we should be happy here. But we're not. Of course we're not. Because it's impossible to be happy within belief. Because we're not experiencing what we truly love, our one and only love, which is certainty. We can't be happy. We were not created to be happy with belief. We were created to be happy with certainty. And so we're just pretending to be happy. There's a lot of people in California that are pretending to be happy. They work at it nonstop. You know, tremendous pretense in California. You go out and go around, everyone's pretending to be happy. How, you know, they think, hey, we're in the best place in the world. You know, the Bay Area of California, most people live here, feel it's the best place in the world. It certainly isn't, you could say that, but it doesn't bring happiness at all. And yet everybody here is pretending to be happy. Me, I don't pretend to be happy. I go out and I look, you know, concerned and stressed and unhappy. Because I realize what's going on. I know what's going on in the world. And it's a very serious situation. Very alarming situation. Very threatening to the gravitation towards certainty. Could be very threatening to it. Very inimical to it. Detrimental to it. And, you know, weather, surroundings, that doesn't bring happiness. But you don't fit in when everyone's pretending to be happy. Everyone's very busy pretending to be happy. It's a full-time occupation. Full-time occupation. You know, you gotta be have your Carrera cruising with the top down, going to wine tasting, attending dinner parties and shopping, and living the, you know, bon vivant lifestyle. And always traveling and going places, and you got to make this enormous effort to have this image or pretense of you're living the good life, you're living the happy life here. And it's expected of everybody here to do that. Nobody's supposed to be unhappy here, so it's very difficult to live here. It's against the law to be unhappy here. It's against the social. I mean, my gosh. No one dares criticize the Bay Area. I don't think anyone here has ever criticized the place, ever. Because, you know, it's like, it's a complete taboo. Because we're all so supposed to be so happy here. How could we be critical of this place? But the weather is ridiculously good. There's no question about it. That's nice. But it doesn't really have anything to do with happiness. Nothing. The external world doesn't really have anything to do with happiness. There are some places that can give some sort of faint echo of certainty, some like attraction, that sort of help awaken the gravitation towards certainty. There are some places that can be like that. If they're insulated from the world, they can be utilized in that way. But external, anything external cannot bring happiness. It's impossible. All this external is there. It's all belief. Came from belief. Generated by belief. The universe is generated by belief. Everything external is generated by belief. Again, reality is not comprised of energy. Energy, belief generates energy. The origin of energy is belief, and the origin of belief is the idea of trying to be prime creator, and the one that is choosing that idea is spirit. So ultimately, it all derives from spirit exercising its freedom to choose ideas, and it chooses experiencing and wanting to try and be prime creator. It all derives from that. But I'm not trying to give pretense of being happy here. I'm just in this little place doing taping, and occasionally I have to go out to the market, get some food, but that's pretty much it. Not trying to live the good life here. For now, I've even given up any golf or anything like that. Just forget about it. Forget it. Doesn't bring happiness. You can be out in the most beautiful weather, in the most beautiful golf course, and great food, and just, you know, everything seems like incredible here, and it has no effect on your true happiness whatsoever. It just gives you a patina of pretense. You get your tan, you're fit, you've got your sporting clothes on, you're recreating on a beautiful day, you know, and you're part of the beautiful life, and you're part of the pretense here. The best place on earth, what is the best place on earth, is still, you know, nothing. Sunlight is coming in now. I don't know, it's about like 77 degrees, just very fresh, soft breeze, just a hint of coolness in the air, you know, perfect October day, gentle light, flowers are all still, you know, blooming, peppers are still growing, you know. We think, what a great place, what a great place. And yet, all around us, the attraction to certainty is being termited. All the houses here in California, you know, they get infested with termites. They really do. It's termite country here. And you got to keep gassing your house, you know, to control the termites. If you don't, the house will be turned into a house of cards, paper mache, you know. Really does. So there's always trouble in paradise, in external paradise, as it were, at least in this world. As belief defines paradise, there's always trouble in that paradise. Lots of trouble. And yet, we're obligated here to pretend that it is, you know, like a really great place, and we're really happy. We're obligated to belief, and belief demands it of those who live here. That belief demands you've got to put on this pretense and stop being attracted to certainty, because this is good enough, right? You're supposed to be happy with this. Supposed to be happy with this. So it's difficult in California for people to really get with the inquiry and the satsang. They're more interested in the spiritual rhetoric, like, how can I have a better lifestyle, how can I pretend to be happy better than I am, and they're hard pressed to admit that their life is completely miserable, and they live in an absolutely wretched place, and all of existence is completely wretched. It's all the play of belief, which is completely merciless and vicious. They're hard-pressed to admit that. And you see, you know, native Californians, they go to their grave, never getting anywhere. They spent their life in the sun having fun, and go to their grave, and they're none the wiser. Still totally part of the cycles of belief. So being a native Californian, I've had the opportunity to get wise to all this and realize, hey, you know, it doesn't matter where you are. You can be in the best place in this world, and you still have to do the inquiry. You still have to do the satsang. You still have to gravitate towards certainty. And if you use the beautiful place where you are and get wrapped up in that, you're wasting your time. So there is this tendency in California to slack, to be slackers.